have enjoyed training my whole life, as Derek has. We've spent a lot of our time on young greenhorns. So we have to do things that keep us safe. And I think safety is an issue for everyone, right? We can all ride safer. So the foundation of the design for me is about riding safer. It was very practical. I spent a lot of time riding on the trail. I love foundation facade. I like massage horses. So if your massage horse will be a trail horse. Your massage horse will be a trail horse. It doesn't matter if the foundation of the massage is there. The massage is the foundation of the riding. So the elements that Tara and I look for in horses is when we talk about the massage training scale. And what those mean to me. So the first element of the dressage training scale is rhythm. So the beautiful thing about Alexia that I quite enjoy is she has a very recognizable rhythm, naturally. Morgan's a very springy step, and Alexia is a very springy step. So something beautiful happened right there that we missed. So I wanted to point that out. Valencia picked up her head, stiffened, and froze. And then yielded and walked off. So, to the untrained eye, what would that be? That would be nothing. But if you're the rider, what you saw was a horse say, "Yikes, I don't think I like that." And the rider said, "It's okay, I'm up here, we're safe." That's the foundation I'm talking about. So in massage, we have essentially massage is making shapes. I call playing the game twister. Okay? Horses naturally are crooked. So that means that if your horse is crooked and bending a little to the right in a certain way, and you need to bend your horse to the left, guess what? It's going to be a lot harder. Your horse's jaw is going to freeze. That whole side of your horse, unless you're talking to it and suffering it, is going to be a train wreck. Oftentimes, right there, a lot of times our lockups, our freezes, our over backwards, those kinds of things could be prevented by being a little proactive and suffering your horse. So, let me go back to the rhythm. I want to watch the lights here. So, how would you describe, Tara, in your, Tara knows the musculature, what's really taking place under your skin. So, there's a beautiful walk. Do you think that horse has a purpose? Do you think that horse arrived at that purpose all by itself? Focus. That horse has focus. She's understanding the walk up with her hinds, up underneath her with some activity, with some interest, with some intention. That's a style of movement. So if you're out on a trail ride, here's a rhythm. If you're out on a trail ride, maybe back up, I want to say on a trail ride. That gives it away. But here's your rhythm. Which way does the horse walk fastest? North, south, east, or west? Depends on which way home is. Okay? So, what kind of a walk do you have when you're walking home? Everybody got a picture of that. And that's the picture that I ride with. I say, horse just showed me something. My horse just showed me something very valuable. I know what he can do. All of the elements of the side are right there. He just showed that he's loose, he has rhythm, he has musculature, cervical straightness, and he's doing it all on his own. All he had to do is coming towards home. So I'm going to replicate that in that horse wherever I am. As soon as I get this out and I'm in the seat, I'm already thinking about that kind of horse. And that's how I ride. And that suppleness, that old top line suppleness, if you were here in past days, I had some very wonderful horses that had tension in bodies. And tension in body means, in my world, means tension in mind. So if I could release tension in body or tension in the mind, I would release the other. So, Tara, what would you do? Can you describe and explain what happens when your horse really moves? You call it getting the ears or the withers. You know, really getting that really long training. And I heard your description of that musculature wise.
Okay.
And I thought it was very, very good.
So just to reiterate, Valencia is 10. I don't always ride her, you know, she made her husband, she's kind of scary. So I'm always busy with a million other things, and when I have time to get on her, I like to make it effective. She's never been in this arena, so she's a little bit booky. Things are echoey, she wants to brace, she's looking at that back curtain. And I think when Jeff started talking about rhythm, what goes hand in hand with rhythm is actually relaxation as well.
Yep.
And your first stage of riding is to make sure in any discipline that the horse can ride relaxed and they feel rhythmical through their body. It's internal. So you're coming from the inside of the body to the outside of the body. A lot of times people talk about the mental stress and of course mentally can't take it, emotionally can't handle it. Most people just concentrate on the physical aspect, but you have emotional and mental as well. That's part of your relaxation. One of the things that I do with the body work or what I do with my riding or training process is I really try to get under the hood of the horse. Because we as trainers and you all sitting there in the audience, I'm sure you felt things on your horse that you just can't quite figure out how you can get to a way. Like when your horse's pole feels like it's pushing up against the ceiling, you would just really like to get it to relax so that it looks long and it's stretched out, kind of like how Valencia is starting to look here. And you feel the back tightening, and you feel like your horse is about to explode at moments. Some days you get on your horse and it feels like the posting trot is never going to happen because it feels like you're falling into a hole. Every time that you sit, you've got to pry yourself out of that hole. All that has to do with your anatomy. Okay. When I talk about a horse in relaxation, what I'm trying to do is stay under the brace. Okay, so under the brace of, as we come around here, Valencia says, would you look at that door? I really want you to look at that door. Would you please look at that back door? I'm really afraid of that back door. Did you see that person get up there? Would you please look at that person get up there? Okay. And I have to, as much as I can, just funnel my energy down into how can I be just a little bit lighter in my hands and allow her to move freely forward. So you can see she's picking up the pace, but it's not because it's faster. And when we come around this corner, she's just, please, Tara, please, would you please? Okay, so as you come around, one of the hardest things to do as a rider is ignore what they really want you to look at. Okay, and it's not that you're throwing their idea of what they're afraid of out the window. It's that you're just replacing it with something else. And if I start to think about the three main neck muscles releasing, it's really going to help me to kind of dissipate this when she comes around the corner. Okay, so I'm going to think spleen's muscle, which is a nice big fat muscle, right behind your ears, that when you put your bridle on, or you're asking the horse to lower the head, and you see that section of the pole where you feel it, it feels like it's kind of tough or hard. And I always say, your horse's body shouldn't feel like your shin, it should feel like your thigh. And it should have a soft, spongy movement to it, and it should feel that way when you ride too. It feels hard and bracy, it feels heavy and bracy, it feels lean, like your horse is leaning on you, and you have a little bit of a heart. Okay, so when we're talking about the muscle that's right here, this muscle right here is your spleen's muscle. That's at the start, okay? You want the horse to spit that ball out and roll it with their nose. If they're holding that muscle and they're pulling their head up in the air, they're going to brace that muscle and that muscle's going to get bigger. Okay? And it's just going to get bigger and bigger to the point where they can't move away from you. You guys all know, you've been on a horse permanent muscle memory. Does anybody have any guesses? How many repetitions? Anybody? What do you think?
Three.
Anybody? At least 3,000. 3,000 good ones. Okay, so that means that if you practice incorrectly, then you can kind of start the cycle over again. Because the muscle memory pattern, and I'm talking about when you get in your car, you know that green light means go, you know where like this stuff. You don't even think about that. Sign in. Things that you don't even think about. When you get on, put your feet in the stirrups and hold your reins. Those things that you naturally normally do, okay, to break that cycle for the horse that does every time I come around this corner, I'm gonna brace the right side of my neck and try to hold it. Okay, we have to find ways to break those cycles. So when we're talking about muscling, we have your spleenius, we also have the brachius cephalic muscle, which is a really big side muscle, pulls the legs forward and also bends and teaches that that muscle pulls the neck sideways. Then we have the supramandibular muscle that goes into the mandible. So it's gonna go from the chest up into the mandible. Those are your three big pullers. Okay, so when the horses are fear flight, when they wanna get out of town, guess what they do? They stick their head up in the air, they fall on their back, they flag their tail, and they run. That is not a riding position. Okay? We try everything in our power to get them to look like an upside down teacup or a rainbow, and they run around looking like that banana or a hammer being thrown away. Okay, so when you start thinking about what we ask from our horses, if we can get them even to a level posture, that's better than trying to get them to a round collected posture. Okay, so I always say, don't close your horses. Don't put them in a frame and shorten your neck. I might go and see you in a frame here.
Yeah, I want to interject there. That's a good demonstration.
So, then the next day when you get on, they're going to go right right back to that place, don't you find?
Oh, it's lovely, Tara. Yeah. Yes. Everybody sees the people that have to change. Yeah, gorgeous. Absolutely gorgeous.
There's a little bracing.
So, Tara is pointing out bracing, and I call it to have access to the side of the course. So, cervical flexion, Tara, can you talk about that side to side? Getting the horse from the tip of its nose to the tail. Access. There's no bracing. The horse is softening the jaw, softening the bowl.
And here on Lizzie, because there's horses walking by, I'm going to get it. She's going, please, do it.
Two exercises. Here's the exercise. Here was the test on the riders. They had to lead their horse from behind, not hold their horse. So I had yield pressure. When I lift the rein, my horse, instead of bracing, is putting yield to that. So when I have a really good yield, he understands the yield, using his head, and then activate the hind. There was no pressure on my hand. He didn't brace against it. Okay? So it may look like there's not a lot going on, but there's a lot going on. My horse is yielding. When I'm going left or right, he's yielding. My hand is hearing him, listening, feeling. He's not pushing against it. That's contact. So yield contact. So I start with one rein. And I want to have this bit of focus. I would give up until my horse yielded downward. I would do it on the opposite rein. Yield. Then I come over here, on this side, say yield, and yield this way, and then I will move location and see if he's still on the foot. And because every horse is locked in the top, I teach this is the best key to lock, moving the hind quarters over. Okay, so I've got a little access to this horse's body. So yield, now activate the hind, no pressure whatsoever. Okay? If he comes in my hand and gets steady, he yields.
That's right.
Okay, so every transition that I am accomplishing, there's a yield in it.
Lower its head. What's also really cool is that when the horse's head goes the trailer and they're really excitable and you can't get them to calm down. You teach this in a controlled environment and 100%. Because every time you leave your area where you just taught the QE, you lose about 35% once you change environments. Okay, so that means that you're only going to be able to start with, you know, like around 70% or so when you start to get to a new environment. So you want to make sure that you have it. Don't teach it halfway and then go to your new environment and wonder why it doesn't work. Okay, you want to make sure that you really, really have it. So I would walk my horses around and just ask them to bend and then drop their head and neck where the pole is lowering. Let's see there again. She said, please look at that person in the audience. And I said, no, drop your head instead. Always replace something that you don't want with something that you do want. Don't get in an argument with them. Just keep having the conversation like Jeff said. I love that. That's great. It's a great way to describe it.
Well, if you have a conversation, have one that's low impact and low pressure, it's on your terms, right?
Right, absolutely. Yeah, because you're always trying to get to, we're all trying to get to a great way result, right? If you come to these expos and watch 10 or 15 different clinicians, we're all going to give you a little bit of a different idea. We're all trying to get to the same basis.
But the difference, Tara, I have to say, for the clarity of your brain, there's no, we're talking about contact. If you notice, Tara and I are the same age here. We work on one brain at a time. I have a thinking hand that's doing all the work, and a holding hand that is brainless. It's just holding. It's keeping the voice from overbending. But I'm doing a lot of talking on one brain, and so my horse understands completely what I'm saying. It's coherent. And I see a lot of riders not really have a clear idea. And so that's what you're seeing here. It's just very clear. One-handed riding.
Yeah, when a horse goes to take that rein and stretch, let them.
Right.
You know, that's something very important. As I'm doing this and I pick up, well, let's say you guys bring your head up, I'm just staying slightly at that bracing point. Okay, so let me show you if I went above the bracing point. I asked her if she resists. That's an awful bracing point. Okay, the horse is going to go and act and take that muscle forward. I need you to just slightly stay. Right where I feel like that muscle kind of melts and it fizzles out and it starts to drizzle down. And that's what I want to feel in my hands. That area, when I look at it, touch it, it should feel like jelly. It should feel like your thigh. And if it looks crazy and hard like it is now, she says, what's that over there? And I'm going to say, oh, I want you to release that muscle group. I want this to be spongy. So if you have to go back and forth, if you start with lateral cervical flexion, which is what Jeff was talking about, then I oftentimes, a little trick that even when I do my classes and training all around, when the horse's head bend is straight, right? They have 7 vertebrae down their neck, 47 down their neck, 54 over there. Okay, so when you're dealing with the horse, you're dealing with 54 vertebrae, that's a lot of vertebrae in the time. 7 down their neck.
Yes.
Okay, so what we have to think about is that the last one, C7, is about right here, and it's going to hide just a little bit behind my first rib. Okay, and if you are a rider that's constantly going like this with your horse, okay, driving and holding, okay, eventually you're going to push the vertebrae back down and condense them back down to the rib. Okay, that's where I go with body work. I'm always getting horses' necks to stretch. I'm always getting those vertebrae open. I'm always getting knots out of poles. I'm always getting all that resistance to come out of the neck. Because that's where the horse can raise it. You know it yourself, right? Most of us walk around like this when we're stressed. We have tech neck, I call it. The people that are at the computer and have their neck is stuck like this. We get really sore. We carry a lot of our tension there. We carry tension underneath our trapezius or our scapula. Well, horses are really no different. They carry it all there too. So what we're trying to do is get that neck to telescope out. Okay? You're not just trying to get the neck to drop. So one of the very important things that I learned is that think about having an old-fashioned lightsaber. Okay? Like in your Tuesday. It's an old light. It's like on the Titanic, right? So you put them around the horse's neck and it just sits here. If the horse lifts the neck, you don't want the horse to you want them to bring the neck out of the leg of the horse. Does that make sense? Okay, so when the horse starts to lift, like how Valiant is correctly, he's lifting from the trapezius cervical and thoracic, right? Your saddle sits on the trapezius thoracic. So you need to make sure that your horse stretches the neck out of the shoulders.
Like
when we're starting to really stretch forward and out on that telescoping neck.
Oh, okay.
Yep. So picture him having even like a hula hoop around his neck. Right? Look at that. Do you see how the head of the neck is expanding out of that? So if the hula hoop is hanging around his neck, how the Jeff has his brain straight. That's where we want the neck and the head to be. Where they're lifting through the chest. It's like taking your balance is then using his core. He's not then just pulling with the front muscles of the neck and pulling with the front muscles of the chest. There you go. Okay, now when you look at Jeff's saddle horn and you see the neck coming out of there, you see how it's a nice, even arc. Can you demonstrate a short? Too short.
Too short? Like you're saying incorrect?
Yeah, incorrect. So look at the difference.
I don't know if he would do it. He'll give me just about anything I have.
Like
I
there. Okay, see how he's starting to fold over and bend back? And he probably won't even push down, but maybe a little bit.
What?
So when the horse has the muscle memory, they won't push down on the bottom section of their neck. Okay, so Valiant, as you can see, would still be lifting a couple of loop if you need to. So that's kind of stuff to think about when you're riding your horse. You want them to head and neck to start from telescope forward, out, up, and down. Okay? And as you even ask for a pulse, you want to think about not shortening your neck. So I'm notorious, I tell my riders all the time, I don't care where my hands are, I'll look big and ugly all day long. Won't see you, but my hands can look pretty off, so I need to do what my horse needs me to do.
Right.
Okay? So if I need to be like this to tell her that's where she needs to be, then I'm going to be going back to tell her that's where she needs to be. So one of the things that I do in the beginning is I ride in what I call the triangle. Okay, so my reins will look more like this. So when you look at the triangle coming towards you, right? So that gives the horse a little bit more base, and I take the triangle up or back. Up or back. Okay, so if the horse starts to come too far in, like Lindsay, where she's just learning, then I want to take that pole out, and then I'll come back to the center. Up, 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 out, to the center. Nope, up, out, to the center. Nope, nope, nope. And just so she can start to feel where I'm on her head, and then I say thank you. And I let her stretch down. Okay, so remember that they can't hold those reins. You cannot hold your horse in prayer. Right? So you can't stay out here and you can't hold and hold and hold and hold and hold and hold and hold without breaks. It's important that you find places for the release. It's very, very important. So even good, release. Good, release. A little bit to right. Like Jeff said, having a conversation. Okay? Step forward into it. Step forward into it.
Yes, yeah, very good. Term.
Good. Carry it. Good job, he lift a little bit. Now she's pulling forward too much, but that's okay. All work in progress. A little flexion, add a little bit of my inside leg to push that hip out a little bit. The shoulder comes down. I'm going to stay her back a little. I'm going to ask for the posting chop, but it doesn't need to be up. I would say it. I just need to stay underneath me. Okay. When I teach biomechanics, you can control your horse's rhythm through your pulse. Okay, it's something that is harder to do sometimes for people to get the hang of it. But basically, I always teach zipper pocket, zipper pocket, zipper pocket, zipper pocket, zipper pocket. And what I mean by that is when I'm up, my zipper of my pants would be straight up and down. A lot of people post like this. They do this half post, or they post like this. Boy, do did I just squash that movement right out of there. Did you guys see how that works? Let's do it again. And that's only just me posting. Becomes like motorboat water skier. Okay, I'm the water skier, she's the motorboat, right out from underneath me. You gotta get to the top of the rise. Okay, so if you can't stand there and stand up, this is the top of your rise. This is the back of your rise. Up and back. It's that much range of motion for you as the rider. So if you're thinking about a cardboard box,
years. come and with horses, not calling anything. But now it's become a thing from Hallelujah. You know, the benefits of that have really been intact. But people are already doing so well. You know, but to me, being aware of it.
To a dressage
test. So that's a good question. So this clinic is about everything you need to know. There's, your question was, what should I try to do?
Yes.
And the answer that I would like to bring is what you need to buy in. Terry's writing in a violent combination kit, which has a horse trainer. It's working on my expression. I think it's really good. It's helping the horse. So, I don't try to be in a box. You know, when you buy one hand or two, it's kind of irrelevant. I buy one hand because I like to.
Yeah.
But for a lot of, because it's Western design, it's so new, Western riders is quite elementary. So, riders are learning everything that Tara talked about. It's kind of now becoming a thing. Precisely. Question.